Okay, let's get started. So, undergraduates, you have finished off the hill climber, moving on to the parallel hill climber now in assignment 7. I think everything there is pretty straightforward. Graduate students, you have submitted now your final project idea. So you're now going to be working on your second weekly report, where next Monday at 11:59 p.m. you're going to be submitting either an image or a video and a short paragraph. And the paragraph plus the image or video is demonstration that you've integrated what you proposed as your first weekly deliverable. Right? So you proposed your idea, broke it down into a series of bite-sized weekly chunks, and you're going to show us that you've implemented it correctly next Monday. Okay, if there is a change, just note that change in your paragraph. So you were hoping to get this, but you tried to implement this, didn't quite work out, so you've changed gears a little bit, and now you're trying to implement this. We're not assessing you that you follow those weekly milestones exactly, because again, there's sort of an estimate of what's possible and what's doable. But when you make a change to your plan, just let us know in your weekly report. All good? Okay, so, yes, Rachel.
I have a question about the schedule.
Schedule, yes.
Next Tuesday is town meeting day.
Next Tuesday is town meeting day, which would be the 6th. Okay, so no class on town meeting day. We'll just move everything down by one day. Thanks for that. I always forget town meeting day. Okay, good to know. Okay, so we're going to finish off lecture 12 today on bipedal locomotion, and that will complete our second theme on sort of the crash course history of evolutionary robotics, coming at it from a minimal cognition point of view, make the simplest possible creature you can and evolve components of intelligence in it, or start with a machine that can get itself from point A to point B, and then maybe we can layer some intelligence on top that way. We'll finish that today, and then we'll move into this longer third theme where we're going to look at some of the challenges or sort of open questions in the field. As I mentioned a few times now, evolutionary robotics is a pretty new field, so there are a lot of big challenges out there to which no one has a good answer. We'll look at some of the answers, but there's certainly lots of room for new ideas. So we'll talk about challenges when we finish off lecture 12. So back to lecture 12. And just to refresh your memory, we're talking about bipedal locomotion, and like any form of locomotion, the animal, or in our case, the robot, is trying to strike some balance between speed, energy efficiency, robustness, and stability, right? We ended last time by introducing this idea of passive dynamic locomotion, and it seems I'm not going to be able to play the video for you, but you can go back and watch it. We have basically a purely mechanical device, right? No electronics, no sensors, no motors. So it's infinitely energy efficient. It's just mechanically turning potential energy at the top of this declined plane gradually into kinetic energy. Then the idea is, and I'm probably not going to be able to play this video either. Oh, no, lucky this time. Is to then take a passive dynamic walker and add motors and sensors to it, where in this case, in Denise here, every once in a while there's a motor that gives a small impulse force, gives a kick to the leg then passively rotates forward, lands, becomes the stance leg, supports the robot's leg, moves backward, gets another kick, and so on. So there isn't continuous actuation of the motors, these intermittent pulses. That's what makes a hybrid dynamic walker. Passive dynamic walker is completely mechanical. So we ended last time by looking at, or starting to look at, an evolutionary robotics experiment, again in simulation now, where can we evolve, first of all, can we evolve passive dynamic walking? Can we evolve a purely mechanical device that can walk down this declined plane? No sensors, no motors. And then, once we've evolved that, can we continue evolving this population of robots and gradually turn these passive walkers into hybrid walkers? So now they're not, they're still pretty energy efficient, not infinitely efficient, but pretty efficient, and now we've increased the robustness a little bit. There are a greater number of environments in which a hybrid dynamic walker can walk, right? The passive dynamic walker sacrifices robustness. It can only walk down this declined plane in favor of energy efficiency. Okay, So that's where we're heading. We have this biped walker here. And again, we're going to start by evolving passive dynamic walking. So no electronics, no neural network. The only thing the evolutionary algorithm is going to be able to play with is morphological parameters. So this is the first experiment. We're going to see where evolution is going to be expanded to be able to tinker with the body of the robot as well as the brain. We have 2 degrees of freedom in the hip, like us, rotate, which allows the leg to rotate forward and back and inward and outward. 1 degree of freedom at the knee, and the ankle can rotate forward and back and yaw about its long axis. Okay, so 5 degrees of freedom for each leg gives us a total of 10 degrees of freedom, 10 joints. We then have an additional 12 morphological parameters. Most of these allow evolution to change the mass distribution. So where is the weight placed on the legs? Can also change the length of the legs itself, the length of the foot, these masses. And we ended last time by introducing this important morphological parameter, the last of these 12 morphological parameters here, which is the starting hip angle around the y-axis. So in each one of the robots that are produced by evolution, it's going to be placed at the top of a declined plane, and BY is going to indicate how much is the swing leg, the flight leg, rotated forward of the stance leg. Then they start the simulation, and because one of the legs is rotated forward, gravity will pull the robot forward, and it will start to move down the declined plane. Make sense? Okay, so we have these 12 morphological parameters that control mass distribution, and we have an additional five parameters, which are springs that are placed on the leg. So there's going to be 5 springs placed on each. Five springs placed on each leg, and each spring is associated with one of the rotational degrees of freedom. So in everything you've been doing in PyroSim so far, you've been creating a rotational joint and then adding a motor to it, and the motor actuates the joint, right? But as you've already seen, you can have a passive joint that has no motor associated with it. What they're going to do in this project is they're going to have a passive rotational joint, and then they're going to add a spring, and then they're then going to motorize the spring, which I'll show you in a moment. And the motorized spring is going to pull, compress the spring, or expand the spring. So imagine a piston inside the coil of a spring, and that piston can extend the spring or pull the spring together. So we've now seen position control, which is a motor that sets the desired angle of a joint. We've seen velocity control, which is the motor neuron outputting a desired velocity for a wheel, for example. And now we're going to see spring control, where the motor is actually going to control a spring, which is sitting near a passive joint. Okay. All right. So how do springs work? Depends, but the easiest way to describe them is with 2 parameters. There's stiffness and damping. And I've tried to visualize here for you with my little cartoon how changing the stiffness and damping of a spring changes the behavior of a spring. So each horizontal axis here is time, and the vertical axis reports the length of the spring, where the horizontal axis itself is the resting length of the spring. So a spring left to its own devices will return to some resting length. You can then pull it, extend it beyond its resting length, which indicates points above the horizontal axis here, or you can actively compress the length of the spring, and the spring becomes shorter than its resting length. Springs that have high stiffness, it's hard to expand them or compress them away from their resting length, which results in a low amplitude when we plot the length of the spring over time. And low stiffness means you have a relatively weak spring and it's relatively easy to push and pull itself away from its resting length. That's stiffness. Damping is when it is perturbed, when it's pulled or pushed away from its resting length, how long does it take to bounce back and forth and eventually return to its resting length? So if we now look along the top pair of images here, we have high damping, which means the spring rapidly returns to its resting length. Low damping or no damping, it will continue to oscillate for a long time or possibly forever.
Okay, crash course in springs. Here we go. So we have five springs per leg. For each spring, we have two numbers, and as you can probably guess by now, evolution is going to set the stiffness and damping coefficients of each of the five springs. We're going to assume in this experiment that everything is bilaterally symmetric, which means whatever we set on one side of the leg, we're also going to set on the other side of the leg. Same thing with the springs. Remember that this is a passive dynamic walker, so we are only going to evolve these morphological parameters. How many morphological parameters do we have in total that we're going to hand over to evolution? We've got 10 here, right? So we've got five springs, and for each of those five springs, evolution has to set stiffness and damping. So that's 10 numbers we're going to turn over to the evolutionary algorithm. Plus, I know it's 8:30 in the morning, but we can do it. 12, I think, right? It should be 12 here. Okay, 10 plus 12, 22 numbers. So we've got a vector of 22 numbers, and those 22 numbers are then going to, we're going to turn that into a genome, right? We're going to have a population of vectors of length 22. So each vector, each individual in the population is able to set the morphological parameters of our biped walker. And as you can probably imagine, the fitness is then going to be how well this thing walks down the declined plan. So no sensors, no motors, no neural network yet. 22 morphological parameters. Okay. We're going to introduce the neural network gradually as we go from the passive dynamic walker to the hybrid dynamic walker. So let's have a look at the neural network first. We're going to gradually introduce it. Like always, we have, or like usually, we have a sensor layer. We have our sensor neurons, we have our hidden neurons, and we have our output neurons, which you've seen before. And we'll talk about those in a moment. But we introduce yet another kind of neuron, a central pattern generator, or CPG. And as it says here, what a central pattern generator does is every once in a while it emits a regular pulse at a regular frequency. So the value of the CPG neuron is usually zero. Usually it's doing nothing, and then every once in a while it hits one and immediately goes back to zero, stays at zero for a while, hits one, and continues. The frequency of the central pattern generator is going to be, I'm going to explain how that's set in a moment. But basically, again, it's kind of like the conductor. It's sending out a beat that influences the rest of the neural network. You have central pattern generators. They're embedded in the spine. So a lot of the work of bipedal locomotion is actually done in the spine, where central pattern generators throughout the spine are sending signals to your arms, if you're moving quickly, and your legs to make sure that you move at a regular rhythm. Your brain is responsible for making sure you don't run into obstacles and all the other aspects of locomotion. But the nuts and bolts of locomotion, keeping a regular gait going, is mostly taken care of by your spine, which explains how the walkers in The Walking Dead are able to walk around, even though they have a brain virus. They're able to stumble around. This is how zombies work, very important aspect of this lesson. You can walk around without your brain for a while, but once you hit obstacles, you tend to stumble and fall down, exactly like the walkers in The Walking Dead. If you've ever wondered how they managed to get about, there you go. Okay, very important aspect of today's lesson. Okay, sensors, most of these should look relatively familiar to you. Most of them end in an A, which is reporting the angle of the joint. So remember, the joint is passive, but it is still being moved by the springs and by the momentum of the body. So we can place our sensors at the angles, which report, at the joints, which report the angles. We also have force sensors, and these are placed on the springs, which report the amount of force that's being applied to the spring at any given time. Some of that force is being applied by the motor, which is actively lengthening or compressing the spring. But there are other forces that are also compressing and expanding the spring, as the robot is moving, what are those forces?
Gravity,
of course, right? So the moment that the robot lifts its foot, for example, there is gravity that's pulling the leg down, which is extending, lengthening the springs a little bit. What other forces are acting on the springs? The motors, gravity?
Friction.
Friction, of course, absolutely. As the foot is trying to lift off the ground, it might catch a little bit and again extend the spring.
Momentum.
Momentum as well, right? So as you rock over your stance foot and your body moves forward and your stance foot moves further and further back, you're actually compressing some of these springs and building up some forces, so they're actually going to push back a little bit. The ligaments in your hamstring do more or less the same thing. Over your stance phase, you actually tense your muscles, and then there is a little bit of elastic recoil when you let go, and it helps push your leg forward. So there are a lot of forces that are acting on these springs, and our robot is going to be able to pick up on them. We also have XL, XY, and Z. So that tells us how much the robot is accelerating about the X, Y, and Z axes. So that's for the whole body. How is the body as a whole accelerating in three-dimensional space? We have the actual angle, so how much is the robot rotated about its x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. So a robot has a little bit of position information, acceleration information, proprioceptive information, what are the angles of the various joints, and what are the forces at the springs. We have those flow through to the hidden layer, as always, and then we have these five motor neurons, which end in VEL, which tells us this is something about the velocity. And so we know that we're dealing with velocity control in this case. Remember that the motors are pistons that are trying to lengthen or shorten the springs. So a positive value arriving at one of these velocity motors will try and increase the length, increase the change in the length of the spring, right? Velocity. A negative number will try and reduce the change in the length of the spring. It will try and compress the spring at a certain rate. A value of zero arriving here says, I want the velocity of the spring, the compression and expansion, to be zero. Question?
You said reduce the change in the length of the spring?
Reduce the change in the velocity. So a positive velocity would mean try and increase the length of the spring by this amount, right? And a negative number would say try and compress it, try and make it shorter by this amount.
Just because you said reduce the change, so that would mean like going closer to zero.
I'm sorry, I misspoke. Reduce the velocity to make it shorter, right? Compressing. A big negative number means compress quickly. A small negative number means compress slowly. Zero means don't change. Small positive number, expand slowly. Big positive number, expand quickly. Yeah. Okay. So we're pushing and pulling on these springs when we get to the hyperdynamic walker, but we haven't got there yet. One last detail to look at to see this picture is they manually put in these two synapses, which are the red dashed lines. Seem kind of odd. Everything else is going to be evolved as usual. What are the red dashed lines doing? Why did they put them in there?
Well, like they're gone between velocity and acceleration because fans know that velocity and acceleration are not related to each other.
They are related.
Maybe like this helps build a memory of this is the like.
Right. So there should be some relationship between ankle X acceleration, which is actually, I think it's on the next slide here. Okay. Here's the X axis here. So velocity about the X axis is the flexing of the foot up and down. What do you think the dashed line represents? Yes.
Feedback.
It's feedback, absolutely. What kind of feedback? So the black lines are going to be placed under evolutionary control when we get to the hyperdynamic walker. Red is just an indicator that the investigator set this one by hand. What do you think the dashed line means? Dashed versus solid. So the dashed line here is going to represent the fact that this is going to be an inhibitory connection. So the greater this is, the less this is. Why would they put that in by hand? The more acceleration about of the foot, the faster the foot is moving up and down, or so yeah, acceleration, the less velocity we want.
They're trying to set a certain gate that it walks out?
They're not going to set the gate, right? The gate is going to come out of this whole thing. They're sort of hacking this one piece of the robot, which is the ankle.
So if the acceleration around the ankle is really high, that means it's like falling over, right?
It's about the, or, it's just the ankle. It may not mean it's falling, but the foot is moving quickly relative to the shank.
Right, it's moving faster and it's accelerating fast.
Yes.
So you want to damp that, and I think that they maybe did that just for stability to try to make sure it doesn't fall over.
That's it. They're trying to damp this down a little bit. The foot shouldn't be waggling around too much. You could have the foot doing this while the leg is swinging. Basically trying to damp things down a little bit. Same with the other dashed line here. It's just a bit of a detail, but just something to keep in mind that often there is a little bit of hand design in here, but generally speaking, we're going to allow evolution to do its thing. Yes?
I'm just trying to get an idea for how these kinds of experiments work. Do you think that they designed the neural network and wanted everything to be under evolution and then discovered that the feet were tap dancing while it was walking as a problem, and then they went fine-tuned that?
Absolutely. It's called fitness function engineering, which you will probably have to do quite a bit of as well in your experiment. When we're trying to get a machine to act autonomously, as we talked about before, it often falls into perverse instantiation. So they might have got a walker that's walking, but the feet are moving like crazy, and they've figured out that they can just put this small hack in here and basically calm the ankles down. Probably had the same thing happening at the hip. But not the knee for some reason. And again, there's some complicated mechanics here going on. Who knows, right? So yes, when you see those sorts of things, they probably were trying to allow evolution to take care of everything. And then they sort of scaled things back a little bit. Yes?
Is there any reason why you'd want to avoid using recursion? It's not really any recursion.
There's no, is there no recursion here? I think you're right. Yeah, it's me. There are signals coming from the CPG to the hidden neurons, but no signals going from any hidden neuron. Well, there are actually, these are hidden neurons here.
Well, yeah, but that's still feed forward. That's just
the
second.
You're right. It's still all feed forward. That's a good question. Yeah, no recursion here. Which, again, as you can imagine, they succeeded in getting passive and hybrid dynamic walking. So apparently, memory is not important for this form of locomotion. Good catch. Okay, you'll notice that there are five motor neurons here. So what you're looking at is actually the neural network for just one leg. This is control of the left leg, and then there's an identical circuit that controls the right leg, right? We're enforcing bilateral symmetry, so the left side of the body looks like the right side of the body. And the left side of the brain looks like the right side of the brain. So basically, this robot has two separate brains, one in the left leg and one in the right leg. And those two brains are going to have exactly the same synaptic connectivity, same synaptic weights. So we got 22 morphological parameters. And we're gradually going to place all of these black synapses under evolutionary control, but not yet. And all those black synapses are going to be the same on the left side of the body and the right side of the body. Yes?
Why would they have two separate networks if the weights and everything are going to be the same? Is it a timing issue, or?
It's just easier to think about it that way. There's probably just one, and they're using it to control both legs. But easier just to think of them as two identical neural circuits. Imagine you didn't do that. Imagine you have this morphologically bilaterally symmetric robot. Left side of the body looks like the right side of the body, but they just had one big brain. So they had all this, and then they had 10 motor neurons, five for the left, five for the right. what kind of gates would you get? You saw some of those gates in the first video for this lecture. Please don't make me act them out.
Silly walks.
The silly walks, exactly, right? So if you go back and watch John Cleese do what John Cleese does best, you'll see that there is bilateral symmetry in his body, obviously. But the gait itself, what he's doing with his left leg, is different from what's happening with his right leg. Thankfully, non-silly walks are bilaterally symmetric. Your left leg and your right leg do exactly the same thing, but they do it out of phase, right? When they do it in phase, you're hopping. Okay, so by enforcing bilateral symmetry in the neural network, they weed out 95% of all the possible silly walks, but not 100% of all the silly walks, and we'll see how they get rid of the remaining 50%. Let's talk about the CPG for a minute. As I mentioned, we have this special CPG neuron that is sort of like the conductor that's taking care of the orchestra, where the orchestra is the neural network itself. We have these two identical neural circuits, left leg, right leg. And so you can now probably imagine what the CPG is going to do. It spikes and sends its spike to the left leg, and then spikes again and sends its signal to the right leg, left, right, left, right. So the CPG is going to enforce anti-phase movement. It's the one that's going to say, left leg, you do your thing now, right leg, you do your thing now, and do them in anti-phase. What the legs actually do when they receive the signal from the CPG is based on the synaptic weights in here. Make sense? Okay. Let's have a look at the fitness function. This looks a little bit different from the ones that we've seen so far. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 terms here. F is obviously fitness, D is obvious distance traveled, T is the amount of torque that's used. This is the actual amount of rotational force that's applied to the joints. In the passive dynamic walker, the piston that's going to control the springs is turned off, it's passive, but because the robot is going to start falling down the decline plane, there's going to be friction and gravity and inertia and momentum and all those things acting on the springs and ultimately on the joints and applying rotational forces. We want to try and minimize those things. We want the robot to move as smoothly as possible.
Are those peak values, or are they summing or averaging, or?
They are summing this over the lifetime of the robot. As a single robot tries to move down the decline plane, they are measuring each of these variables. Okay, hip rotation about the x-axis, so that's how much the robot tips forward and backward as it moves down the decline plane. Hip rotation about the z-axis, how much does the robot rotate about its long axis as it moves down the decline plane. And hip rotation about the y-axis, which is how much the robot tilts around the y-axis as it tries to move down the decline plane. And finally, feet rotation about the z-axis, how much are the feet twisting left and right as the robot moves. Which of these is reward terms and punishment terms? Do we want to maximize D, minimize D, maximize T, minimize T?
Minimize T?
We want to minimize T, right? So usually when you see 1/1+, you usually know that's a punishment term. Right? Assuming that that variable stays positive, which it does in all these cases, we want to try and minimize them. What about the other five? We want to minimize all the other five and maximize just D, which makes sense, right? So we want to maximize D, and you can probably guess that they started with F equals D, and what did they get? They got silly walks, even though they had enforced bilateral symmetry, right? So if you don't minimize, if you don't minimize X, then you're going to get something that walks like this as it goes down the declined plane. So they probably got something like that, went back in and added 1 plus 1/x, said, okay, now it's going to work. They ran it again, and then they got something that did this. So they went back and put in 1 over 1 plus y, and so on and so forth. I think of all the slides you're going to see in this lecture, this one is the best example of perverse instantiation, right? There are many, many, many ways to walk in a silly manner, which aren't very energy efficient. And so we need to do a fair bit of work to make sure we get something that looks like our form of bipedal locomotion without explicitly saying, lift this leg, then extend the knee, then tense the ankle to get ready for hitting the ground, and then, and then, and then. So we're one step short of telling every spring or every piston inside the spring exactly what to do. We're still letting evolution figure out how to get this thing to move, but we're certainly constraining it by saying, here's what we want, D, and here's a whole bunch of other things that we don't want. Okay, so let's now move on to the actual experiment. They actually did this using an idea called shaping. You'll also see this called scaffolding in some of the experiments we're going to look at later. This is a very common idea that comes from psychology. So if you want a robot or a young human infant, for example, to learn something, you often scaffold or shape its experience to make it easier for it to learn. And then as the agent starts to learn that competency, you gradually start to remove the scaffolding. Most obvious example of that is training wheels on a bicycle. Very hard to learn to ride a bike without training wheels. Very difficult task. So we can start by making the task simpler and then gradually remove the training wheels. Okay, how did they do that in this experiment? Well, in the first phase, as I mentioned, we're just going to evolve the morphology, and I misspoke a little bit. I'll come back to the slide in a moment. They evolved the synaptic weights just from the CPGs to the motors. And why did they do that? Well, they evolved the synapses that connected the CPGs to the motors because at the beginning, when they're about to evaluate a new robot, they put the robot at the top of the decline plane. They've got one leg up like this. The CPG emits one pulse and then goes quiet for the rest of the evaluation period. And that one pulse causes the robot to jerk a little bit and then start moving passively down the declined plane. So it's not 100% passive, but we're almost there. Okay, make sense? Okay. Unfortunately, they didn't shoot videos of these, which is a real shame, but they were able to evolve passive dynamic walking, and they got something that walked down all the way down to the bottom of the declined plane. Once they evolved with this fitness function and got something that successfully exhibited passive dynamic walking, they moved on to phase two, where they're now going to task evolution with gradually turning the passive dynamic walker into a hybrid dynamic walker. How did they do that? Well, they just continued evolving the synaptic weights that connected the CPG to the hidden neurons and on to the motor neurons. They continued evolving the 22 body parameters, and they added a new term to the fitness function, 1 over 1 plus V. So they're penalizing V. They want to minimize V. What is V? It's the difference between how the robot moves when it's walking passively, when it receives just one pulse of the CPG at the beginning, and then the CPG is quiet throughout the evaluation period, and how the robot moves when it's a hybrid dynamic walker. So they're going to evaluate now every robot twice, once in the passive case where it gets just one CPG pulse, and then they're going to bring it back to the top of the decline plane, evaluate the same robot again, but now the CPG is going to send its beat left, right, left, right, left, right, as the robot moves down the decline plane. What frequency should the CPG emit these left, right beats? They determine it from the actual movement of the robot itself. So during the evaluation period of the robot, in the hybrid phase, in the hybrid evaluation, one of the legs starts up, the robot receives one CPG pulse, and it starts to move, it starts to rock forward, and they record how long until the swing phase strikes the ground with its heel. And the amount of time between the beginning of the evaluation period and that first heel strike, That's now the frequency of the CPG. So now it will beat, beat, beat at that frequency. Remember that evolution can set the length of the legs. So if you have a very tall robot with a relatively large BY, meaning the leg is pretty high up in front of the robot, it's going to take quite a long time for the heel to strike, and you're going to have a pretty low frequency CPG. If you have a short robot and a small BY, it might take very short, rapid steps down the declined plane in the passive case, so you get a high frequency CPG. So the frequency of the CPG is being set by the anatomy of the robot, not unlike how you, the CPGs in your spine are tuned up as your anatomy changes as you grew from an infant into an adult. So our frequencies, again, as we saw earlier in this lecture, are all at about one hertz, so one step per second, but not quite. It's a little bit fine-tuned to your physiology. Okay, so far so good? Finally, in the third phase, once they had hybrid dynamic walking, they had a robot that could walk with these pulses, very much like it did in the passive case. Now they're gradually going to fold in the sensors. So now they're going to reconnect in the sensors to the neural network with small connection weights. So weights that are very close to zero. So now they're going to add in all of these synapses, but they're going to start by setting the weights very close to zero, and then evolution can fiddle with those synaptic weights in this third phase of evolution. Why start by setting these synaptic weights close to zero? Why not just wire in the sensors and just set initial random values like we've seen several times before?
You lose all your progress,
right? Suddenly, you're sort of giving the robot eyes and ears and all these senses, and all this new information starts flooding in, and if all these weights are far from zero, there's a huge flood coming in, and it's going to disrupt the movement of the legs as dictated by the CPG. So at the beginning, the robot in this third phase can barely sense its angles and forces and position and acceleration. And then gradually, evolution might tune up those weights. We're going to continue using 1 over 1 plus V. So even with the robot's sensors turned on, we want it to try and walk down the decline plane in the same way it did as in phase number 1. Okay, so here's a figure of a single evolved sensor-based walker now. So we have in blue the CPG. So you can see the CPG emitting a pulse every, whatever that is, 37 time steps. And again, that frequency was set by the physiology of this particular robot. We can see that the hip starts to rotate forward. So you can imagine the leg coming forward. It reaches some maximum angle and then starts to rotate backward as the robot's body moves forward and the rest of its body rotates over the hip. So, and at the same time, we see that the knee is also extending and then coming back and extending and coming back. So we can actually see a little bit, if you can parse this figure, you can see a little bit of the motion of a leg in response to a pulse from the CPG. Okay. So now we have a robot that can walk down the decline plane. And I think I forgot to mention one detail here. In phase 2, as evolution is proceeding and the robots are evolving to exhibit hybrid dynamic walking, they're also gradually lowering the declined plane until at the end we have one robot that can walk passively down the declined plane and the same robot when placed on flat ground and its CPG emits pulses at a regular frequency will exhibit hybrid dynamic walking. And that motion of the hybrid dynamic walking will be very similar to the velocity profile of the passive dynamic walking. So by gradually lowering the decline plane, this is like gradually removing training wheels from a child's bike as the child learns how to ride a bicycle. So that's gradual removing of the scaffolding. Make sense? Okay. This is one of these experiments where they just kept going. So that was phase 3. They kept going into phase four. They wanted to see, could they actually continue to expand the robustness or stability, if you like, of this passive, of this hybrid dynamic walker. The robot can now walk over flat ground. So they continued evolving for another 100 generations. And as they did, they applied small external random force, impulse forces to the robot. So they randomly pushed against the outside of the robot. So you can think of this as wind. And they reported that they developed, or they evolved, dynamic mechanisms to adapt to noise. So the robot was actually sensing these perturbations. Remember, the sensors give information about position and acceleration, and it would actually correct its gait as it's moving. So when pushed too far to one side, the machine was observed to adjust its foot placement by stepping inward again to regain its balance. Not unlike Boston Dynamics' Big Dog, also was able to recover its gait when kicked or pushed. Okay, here's a visual of this. So they're reporting on the horizontal axis here greater and greater wind forces. So they were pushing with greater and greater random forces to one evolved walker. When there is no wind, it takes a total of 37 steps, either before falling down, or maybe that was the end of the evaluation period. They didn't say. Up to a certain intensity, the robot continued moving as before, but obviously as the forces become greater, it falls over earlier. So robust, but again, robust up to a point. This one's kind of interesting. Robustness to internal perturbations. This is phase five. They kept going. So now they evolved the robot where every time they evaluated a robot, they added a little bit of noise to these 22 morphological parameters. So if you add noise to L, sometimes you get a shorter robot or a taller robot. And again, when they introduced more and more errors to the construction process of the robot, if you like, up to a point, the robot was still able to succeed perfectly, but after a while, it started to succumb to these internal errors. Why would you bother doing this, aside from the fun of it?
To understand how
How it will break down in real life. One of the open challenges that we're going to see probably next week is the reality gap problem. Evolve something in simulation, transfer it to reality. Most of the time, it doesn't work. So what can we do in simulation before transferring to reality? We can maybe try and expand the robustness and stability profile of our robots by exposing them to external change and maybe also internal change. We may get to the point where we can 3D print our robots, and 3D printers are not going to be perfect. There's always going to be slight manufacturing errors. It would be nice if our robots are going to be robust to manufacturing errors. This one is not a further phase of evolution, but it's an interesting experiment. They reached into, again, one of the evolved walkers, and as the walker was walking, they played with the frequency of the CPG. So if you look carefully in this picture, and it's a little hard to see, in the middle of the picture, the red spikes are closer to one another than they are to the left side of the figure. So left side of the figure, this is the default frequency of the CPG. In the middle, the spikes bunch up a little bit, so they're speeding up the CPG. And then in the right-hand third of this figure, they're actually slowing the frequency of the CPG. And the purple shows the stride length. And as you would expect, as the frequency is increased, the CPG beats are coming faster, the robot, in order to maintain walking, is going to have to take shorter steps. The heel is going to have to strike the ground earlier to keep up with the CPG. And in fact, the robot has adapted to different CPG frequencies. When the CPG frequency is slower, the robot has to take longer and longer strides to slow down the time between heel strikes to keep it in sync with the CPG. This is a nice property, obviously. It means that the robot could take control of its CPG and it could speed up and slow down its own walking by simply increasing or decreasing the frequency of the CPG. But it's also, if you think about it, a little bit mysterious. They never evolved this robot to be robust to changes in CPG frequency. So why is it robust to CPG frequency. This robot, during evolution, it only ever saw one CPG frequency, its own frequency, but it's robust to different frequencies. Why? Remember that the CPG frequency is set by the physiology of the robot. What was the CPG frequency of the parent of this robot? Was it the same as the frequency of this child? Probably not, right? Remember that evolution is playing with these 22 morphological parameters. So the morphology of the parent of this robot was probably different from the morphology of the child, which means their CPG frequencies were probably different. One might have been taller, one might have been shorter. The parent, if it was able to produce a child, must have had high fitness. So it must have been able to walk and be robust. It must have been able to walk in response to its CPG frequency. Its neural network must have been able to handle that frequency. The parent's neural network is going to be very similar to the child's. Might not be identical, but very, very close. So those two neural networks embedded in two different bodies had to handle two different frequencies. Right? So in essence, this final evolved robot that we're looking at is robust to CPG frequencies because it's inherited its ancestors' abilities to deal with different CPG frequencies. The reason I'm going on about this is one of the nice aspects of evolution. We are all the product of the fact that our parents survived and reproduced, your grandparents survived and reproduced, and so on and so forth. And indirectly, you have inherited a lot of the adaptive strategies of your ancestors, same way the robot here has. It's robust to one aspect of its design, CPG frequency, without us explicitly having to make it be so. Kind of interesting. Okay. Any questions about that before we move on to lecture 13? Okay. Let's switch gears here. So just back to the schedule for a moment. So we're now going to start in on theme number 3, open challenges in the field of evolutionary robotics. There are a lot of them, and I've tried to organize these in sub-themes, but they all sort of derive from one overall challenge in the field, which is scalability. So you just saw a robot that's able to exhibit hybrid dynamic walking, but it cannot perform ACB, active categorical perception. Last week, we saw a robot that could exhibit active categorical perception. It could perceive different shapes of objects, but it was just an arm, couldn't walk, right? We can tend to evolve robots that do one thing and do one thing well, but getting them to do lots of things at the same time or under different conditions, very difficult. Same thing in AI. We can get a machine that is fantastic at Go, but if you take the same machine and try and get it to play chess, no dice, vice versa. Right? We can create machines, either disembodied or embodied, that get very good at one thing, but getting them to be good at lots of different things, very difficult. So in the field of AI now, this idea of AGI is becoming increasingly interesting, which is artificial general intelligence. Right? Some of you are very good at one thing, and thankfully you're also pretty good at lots of other things, right? You're a generalist much more than the machines are going to see in this class. Okay, so all of the sub-problems here we're going to deal with are trying to get robots to be robust and be able to do what they do and do more and more things under a growing number of conditions. In order to do that, we're going to have to try and scale up the way that we do things, right? Everything you've seen up till now, I've said, here's one environment, here's one task, here's one fitness function, here's one robot, and it worked. Clean the slate, start again, right? Another environment, another task, another robot. How do we actually scale this up to get more and more robots to do more and more things? That's the general challenge, scalability and generality. So we're going to break this down into a few subproblems. First one we're going to look at in lecture 13 is modularity. So humans are now collectively pretty good at building very, very complex things like these things and the International Space Station. We do it by making them in a modular fashion. We break these complex things down into smaller and smaller and digestible pieces and then put them back together again. We do the same thing with our own behavior. That's the idea of modularity. So how do we get evolution or our robots to do things in a modular fashion? We're going to look in lecture 14 at an evolutionary algorithm called NEAT and its sequel, HyperNEAT. This has to do with how we translate the genotype or the string of numbers, which is the blueprint of the robot, into the phenotype. This is another important problem. We just mentioned crossing the reality gap. So if we get better at evolving things in simulation and we get better at 3D printing so we can keep evolving and keep manufacturing robots, more and more of them, more quickly, more cost effectively, that's one way to try and scale up AI and robotics. But in order to do that, we're going to have to be able to transfer things from simulation to reality. Difficult. And we're going to look at 1, 2, 3, 4 different ways to do this. And then we're going to look at two projects from my group, two recent projects about trying to scale this up through crowdsourcing. So as you just saw with the hybrid dynamic walker, it's often very difficult to write down a fitness function. You often have to go back and forth quite a few times to get it right. Maybe we could collectively get people to design fitness functions and crank out more and more robots that do more and more things more and more robustly. Okay, that's sort of an overview of theme number 3. Let's dive in to our discussion on modularity. Okay, again, this is on the surface a very intuitive concept to a lot of us, and this comes up in lots of different domains. It's a very important concept, for example, in engineering. However, it has different meanings or different definitions in different domains, but sort of the similar concept, and we're going to focus for the moment on just the concept of modularity. What we're talking about usually in modularity is tight local connectivity or coupling and sparse or no coupling between parts or modules, right? So a good example, if you're familiar with object-oriented programming, OOP itself was designed to allow modular design of software. Why does modular design help us build up more and more complex things? Because we can work on one thing and change one part, one module, and if that module is loosely connected to other modules, then changing this module is not going to disrupt the function of other modules. Think about all the neural networks you've seen for these robots so far, right? It's a mass of spaghetti. Everything's connected to everything else. If evolution changes this one synaptic weight, that change usually propagates outward through the network and affects how the robot moves, and usually the robot will fall over if it's a biped, right? So usually we don't have very modular solutions for our robots, and it makes it hard for evolution to tune these non-modular networks. Okay. So here's an example again, just from object-oriented programming. So you're all working with PyroSim now. And as you know, in PyroSim, you're sort of developing these robots in a hierarchical fashion. So hierarchy is sort of a related concept to modularity. One way to do good OOP, good object-oriented design, is to create different classes or different objects and then hide all the nitty-gritty details of that object away from the other objects that need to talk to one another. So typically, when you're doing good OOP design, you're creating a public interface. So what that means is you have a given class, maybe called robot, and other parts of your code can call this class. They can create robots, delete robots, draw the robot in the simulator, but they don't know anything about the internal details of that object. It's all hidden. There's a lot of coupling inside these methods or these functions associated with this object, but there are only a few functions or there are only a few ways for objects to communicate with one another. All right, that's modular software design. Okay. We're going to distinguish for a moment between two different forms of modularity. Again, there's lots and lots of different ways of defining what we mean by dense connectivity locally and sparse connectivity globally. We can talk about the structure itself, which is if we take a network, like a neural network, where the nodes represent neurons and the edges represent synapses, and if we wire everything up to everything else, then as the number of neurons increases, the number of synapses increases quadratically, right? N times N minus 1 over 2, or N times N minus 1. Okay, so by stipulating that we're going to go after structural modularity, meaning that not every neuron is connected to every other one. We're going to try and develop semi-independent neural circuits. We can reduce the total number of synapses, which might help evolution. We can also talk about functional modularity, and we saw that in the case of the humanoid robot that was shaking the block up and down three times and left and right three times. So here's a couple of pictures to help drive home this point. This figure was actually taken from that humanoid robotics experiment. So on the left, this is a visualization of structural modularity. We have three things we want the robot to do: green behavior, red behavior, and blue behavior. We could create three different neural circuits, and then a fourth circuit, which is this gating mechanism, which releases each of these neural circuits to control the motors. That's structural modularity. It's nice because we reduce the number of neurons, we reduce the number of synapses, but we also have to keep growing the network as the number of things we want the robot to do increases. So if we want to create machines that do hundreds or thousands of things well, we don't want to have hundreds or thousands of circuits dedicated to each of those one thing. So functional modularity was this idea, again, where we have a fixed neural network. It may be structurally non-modular. Structurally non-modular in the sense that most of the neurons are connected to other neurons, but we can keep evolving it to produce more and more of these motor primitives or these simple behaviors by changing the synaptic weights within this system. And here's my little cartoon of structural modularity. Okay, so we're gonna see functional and structural modularity in the experiment we're gonna look at today and on Thursday. Okay, so here's what we're going to try and do in this experiment. Given the task we want the robot to do, there are two general strategies we could pursue. We could sit down, think about the task, and try and break it into subtasks, and then evolve the robot to do each of those subtasks and do it in the right conditions, which is exactly what they did in this experiment. They said, okay, robot, I want you to learn these motor primitives, shake up and down, shake left and right, and then put them all together. Or we could be a little bit more ambitious and turn the task over, take the task of modularizing a complex task over to evolution. Let evolution come up with ways of breaking the task down into simple modules. The challenge here is that often what we think of as a good way to modularize a system might be very different from the way that evolution modularizes a system. Remember that thinking about thinking is misleading. So the reason that thinking about thinking is often misleading is because we're often thinking about behavior from a distance. This is the distal perspective of behavior. So we might look at this simple Kepler robot here with its two wheels, and it's got five distance sensors. And we watch from afar, we watch this robot driving around in its environment, and it brushes past a cylinder, and a little bit later it brushes past a block. And we say, okay, those are two different things. At this point in time, though, in this cartoon example, if instead we take a proximal perspective on behavior, proximal meaning close to, we literally put ourselves in the robot's shoes, and we only look at what the robot sees, we only see what the robot sees. This is what the robot sees at this point in time when it's next to the cylinder, and this is what the robot sees when it's next to the cube. From the robot's point of view, these are exactly the same thing. Now, of course, this is a robot in motion, so over time, it may sense that these two objects are different. So this is just a cartoon example to show that we might break this up and say, okay, robot, you should do behavior A when you're near a cylinder, and you should perform behavior B when you're near a square, which the robot in this cartoon example cannot obey because these are exactly the same situation. Am I supposed to do A or B? So even if we want to try and achieve AGI by trying to break things down into simpler and simpler tasks, and then evolve the robot to do each of those simple tasks, and then get evolution to stitch those simple tasks together back into more complex behavior, we may get it wrong. We may be partitioning the problem in the wrong way. We're partitioning it from our point of view, from our distal behavior. We want a robot to clean up this room. So in order to do that, it should look for pieces of paper, it should look for soda cans, treat them differently, put them in different boxes. We're breaking the task up into these modules, which are not going to be appropriate for the robot. So we're going to try this more ambitious task of getting evolution to come up with its own modularization of a task. Okay, what's the task? This is a relatively old paper, actually, so we're going back to the Kepera for a moment. It's a little two-wheeled robot. It's got its little gripper in this case, and it's going to be moving around inside an arena, and it's a walled arena, and inside that arena are going to be five little wooden cylinders, and it's going to have to find them, grab them, pick them up, drive to the edge of the arena, and drop the cylinder outside the arena. So a wooden cylinder cleaning upping robot. Okay, what does this robot have? Much like we've seen before, it's gonna have six infrared sensors, so basically six distance sensors, and it has a seventh light barrier sensor. So this is a little laser between its two pincers, and when that laser beam is broken, it knows there is an object within its grasp, and when the laser beam is unbroken, it's not holding anything, or there's nothing there to grasp. We're going to have four motor neurons. The first two are going to directly control the wheel, so velocity control. First motor neuron, how quickly does the left wheel spin? Second motor neuron, how quickly does the right motor spin? Third and fourth motor neurons are going to trigger these little simple motor primitives, object pickup and object release. Make sense? Okay, so let's think about this task, and I've already warned you that thinking about thinking is misleading. But for most of us, again, if you were to sit down and do this yourself, you'd probably come up with a partitioning not too different from this. We want the robot to move around, obviously, or else it's never going to find any of these objects. We might then further partition this subtask into two sub-subtasks. Into a Breitenberg vehicle. If there's nothing in front of you, drive forward. If there's something on your left, turn a little bit to the left. If there's something to your right, turn a little bit to the right. Or sorry, if there's something on your left, turn to the right. We want the aggressor in this case. Go towards objects in your environment. You've got to find these wooden cylinders. If you come close to an object, move in a position so that move so that the object is between your pincers. Then pick up the object, then move towards the wall, then recognize the wall, make sure that you get the object outside, and then let go, and rinse and repeat. Right? This would be something that would make sense from our point of view. As you can probably imagine from this setup now, evolution is going to find something very different from this. Okay. How did they enable evolution to come up with its own modules? Well, they did so by designing five different neural network architectures. These are four. I'll show you the fifth one in a second. And they did this in a nice principled manner. They started with the simplest possible thing they could imagine. They took their seven sensors and connected them directly to the motors. So no hidden neurons, no recurrent connections, simplest possible thing you can imagine. Network B, they put in four hidden neurons. Network C, they added recurrent connections. They've just drawn it in a different way. So if you look carefully, we've got our seven sensors here. They connect to two of the four hidden neurons. Those two connect back to these hidden neurons, which also connect to the first two. So there's a recurrent cycle in there. One additional detail that we haven't seen before is not only do we have connections from sensors to hiddens to motors, but also directly from the sensors to the motor neurons. We have combination of both. They then manually designed network D, and they built in some modularity. They said, okay, maybe these seven subtasks are a little bit too much, so let's just force two different modules, two different behaviors that are going to come up under two different conditions. When the gripper is empty and when the robot is actually holding something. So
we're going to evolve all of these synaptic weights, and when the robot is not holding an object, these four neurons are going to be in control of the four motors. And when the robot manages to actually grab an object, these four neurons are going to be in charge of the motors. So they're enforcing modularity here. We have these two neural circuits. So far, so good? Okay. Network E, this one takes a little bit to wrap your mind around. This one was designed to allow evolution to come up with its own modules. How does this work? Well, we've got our seven sensor neurons, and we have at the top, you'll see four groupings of four neurons. So one grouping for each of these four motor primitives, spin the left wheel, spin the right wheel, pick up and release. We have white neurons and black neurons. So the white neurons are normal motor neurons. The black ones are selector neurons, and they work as follows. Let's just look at the left-hand set of four neurons here. Depending on the synaptic weights, at every time step, we're going to look at this pair of selector neurons for the left motor. If the left selector neuron's value is greater than the right selector neuron's value, then the left-hand output neuron takes control of the left motor. If the right selector is greater than the left selector, then the right output neuron takes control of the right neuron takes control of the left motor. So there are two neural circuits here. This one, all the synapses arriving here, and a second neural synapse, which is all the synapses arriving here. And which of those two circuits has control of the left motor is controlled by the selector neurons, which are in turn influenced by the sensor. So evolution can tune up these two different circuits, which might control the left motor in different ways, two different modules. And when these two modules take effect is going to be dictated by the selector neurons and ultimately by the sensor neurons. So what conditions will trigger the use of these different neural modules? Make sense? Okay, so in each of these four groupings, we have a pair of selector neurons, so we have a pair of modules. How many total states, and I put states in quotation marks here, because this is all one continuous system, how many sort of discrete combinations of these modules are possible?
16.
16, right? So we could have that the left circuit in each of the four pairs is in use. That's state one. State two is left, 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 right circuit for the release. That's state two, and so on, right? So if we treat the left and the right circuit as a zero or one, we have 2^4 or 16 possible states. 16 possible combinations of these modules can be used at any one point in time. Okay. Just to test your intuition about this network, let's imagine that evolution says, in a way, it says, I don't want any modularity for this problem. It's not required. I can do everything with a fully connected network as usual. What would you expect? How would you expect that network to behave? If evolution said, thanks for the option of using modularity, but I'm not going to use it, I'm going to use network E, and I'm going to tune the weights so that I just use this network in a non-modular way. How would this network behave? What would the selector neurons be doing in that case?
Would it set them equal to each other or alternate between them somehow?
So if it set them equal or alternated between them, then it would mean that sometimes the left selector is greater than the right selector neuron or vice versa, which means it's switching back and forth between different modules at different times, which would be evolution making use of the modularity we gave it.
So all the selector neurons would be constantly on at all steps?
Exactly, right? So it could be that all the left selector neurons are always greater than all the right selector neurons, that they never switch, right? They're just whatever they are, and then we just have all of these seven sensor neurons controlling the four
motor neurons, right? It's not switching back and forth between modules. So the moment that we see a left selector neuron change relative to the right selector neuron, that's evolution saying, thank you very much. I did need two different modules under different conditions. Okay. So we have five different neural network architectures, A, B, C, D, and E. We're going to do five sets of experiments where we evolve synaptic weights for these five different architectures. And as you can imagine, the question we're going to ask is, which one did better? Okay. By doing this in this incremental fashion, we can not only investigate modularity, but we can also investigate whether internal or hidden neurons are useful for this task. So if B does better than A, we know that hidden neurons are useful. If C does better than B, then we know that recurrent connections are useful for this task. Does the robot need memory for this task? It's kind of hard to say. If D does better than A, B, and C, that means what we thought was right, that it's useful for evolution to be able to switch back and forth between two modules, the two modules you see in D there, under different conditions. If E does better than A, B, C, and D, that means modularity is useful, but the kind of modularity we made available to evolution was not appropriate. Turns out, as always, evolution is smarter than we are. So modularity is definitely useful for this task. The fitness of evolved E networks were better than the fitness of the other four. They started to catch up after a while, but it took quite a while. The clear winner was E here. They did all this work in simulation. How did they do this? So they took each controller, A, B, C, D, or E, dropped it into the robot, and then dropped the robot into the arena 15 times. So these are these 15 epochs. During each epoch, they started the robot at a different position and a different orientation inside the arena, and they let the epoch run for 200 time steps of the robot, which they call actions here, or the robot found an object, grabbed the object, carried the object to the edge of the arena, and threw it outside. Okay. So successful epoch, how many out of those 15 epochs did the robot successfully find and throw away an object? That's the fitness function. It's a little more complicated than that, but we won't go into it. It's not important for our purposes. One of the really cool things about this experiment is they did evolve it in simulation, and they used a simulation that was popular back at this time, and it was very finely tuned for the physical Kepler robot. So they managed to cross the reality gap. They took a bunch of evolved networks from simulation and transferred them to reality. And most of the E networks, or a lot of the E networks, successfully transferred to reality. Not only did the E networks enable the robot to clean up the simulated arena, they took that E network, evolved E network, dropped it into the physical robot, and also cleaned up the arena. Okay, we've got 2 minutes left, so let's try and answer these questions. First of all, is there a correspondence between evolved modules and distal behavior? So was there actually a correspondence between the modularity found in the E network and something we might be able to understand? And the result is actually no. The reason why is as follows. It turns out that three of the four groupings here were never switched. They were hardwired. So the left and the right selector neurons were always kept the same numbers relative to one another. It was only the right motor in which the left selector and the right selector alternated. So evolution said modularity is useful in this case. All I need to be able to do is use two different modules to control the right motor. For the other three motor neurons, they can always keep using the same circuitry throughout these 15 epochs. Okay, which already, hopefully, seems pretty non-intuitive to you. I haven't told you the conditions under which these two circuits controlling the right motor changes, and it takes a little bit of mental effort to dive into that, so I think we will leave that for Thursday. Have a good day. Remember, you have a quiz due tonight, and good luck with assignment 7. Thank you.